Welcome to the Mop-Up. We're coming to you live from an air shaft overlooking a parking garage somewhere in Manhattan where it's 4,000 degrees. And believe it or not, it's cloudy outside. I'm David Feldman, bringing you first world problems on a third world income. On today's show, if all goes well, and it usually doesn't, Professor Ben Burgess and Pete Dominic remember Donald Rumsfeld, who, as I said, passed away this week. Donald Rumsfeld, the youngest and oldest person ever to be defense secretary, went into the great known unknown at the age of 88. Rest in war, Donald Rumsfeld. Rumsfeld served valiantly. He served courageously. He served our nation's military industrial complex brilliantly, twice, first under the Ford administration, and then under George W. Bush, where he blundered his way into Baghdad, killing at the very least 400,000 to 700,000 Iraqis. Rumsfeld first served as defense secretary in the Ford administration, where he became best friends with Dick Cheney, who, when elected vice president, pushed for Rumsfeld to become defense secretary yet again. And then after 9/11, the buildings had barely come down, and already Rumsfeld was saying, let's blame 9/11, let's blame Iraq for 9/11. Immediately after 9/11, the day of September 11th, Rumsfeld pushed for an invasion of Iraq. To refresh your memory, Iraq had nothing to do with 9/11, zero, zip, nada. He immediately walked up to CIA Director George Tenet and said, find anything you got that links these attacks to Iraq. Just find anything. I don't know if you remember a guy named Clark. He was a chief counterterrorism advisor on the National Security Council. He served under Clinton and then under President George W. Bush. He was a holdover from the Clinton administration. And when Rumsfeld took over the Defense Department, Richard Clark, I believe his first name was Richard Clark, he said to Rumsfeld, trust me on this. Your biggest concern is Osama bin Laden. And of course, Rumsfeld ignored Richard Clark. And Clark wrote a book about this. And in his book, he wrote that on 9/11, in the very first emergency meeting on the day of these attacks, Rumsfeld said in the Situation Room, why shouldn't we go into Iraq? Not just Al-Qaeda, let's go get Iraq. And Clark wrote that Rumsfeld kept saying, we need to bomb Iraq. We need to bomb Iraq. And Richard Clark said, no, Iraq had nothing to do with this. Al-Qaeda is in Afghanistan and parts of Pakistan. Leave Iraq out of this. And Rumsfeld on 9/11 said to Richard Clark, but I know that Iraq had nothing to do with this, but there aren't any good targets in Afghanistan, quote, and there are plenty of good targets in Iraq, Donald Rumsfeld. Before and during the Iraq War, Donald Rumsfeld claimed that Iraq had active weapons of mass destruction. He insisted in the lead up to the war in Iraq and to the illegal invasion of Iraq that Iraq had WMDs. He gave a famous press conference on February 12th, 2002, about a month before the invasion. And he said, there's no doubt that Saddam Hussein has weapons of mass destruction. On March 30th, 2003, when the war was just getting going, Donald Rumsfeld went on ABC's This Week, and he said to George Stephanopoulos, we know where the weapons of mass destruction are. And then he got specific. He said they are in to Crete and Baghdad, east of Tikrit, west of Baghdad, and they never found weapons of mass destruction. He led us into a war that cost trillions of dollars, thousands of American lives, maybe a million lives in Iraq when you add up the health consequences of the invasion, of the water being turned off, the electricity being turned off. Lancet says it could be as close to a million Iraqis died from the invasion, not to mention 2-3 million Iraqis who lost their homes, who became refugees because of this Donald Rumsfeld, who, by the way, would robo-sign his condolence letters to the parents and the wives and the husbands of the soldiers who died in Afghanistan. He didn't even have the decency. He signed about 1,000 condolence letters using a machine instead of this, a pen. He ignored all the warnings in the lead up to the invasion of Iraq. He ignored, as I said earlier, Richard Clark's warning that his biggest problem would be Osama bin Laden. Instead, Rumsfeld, as defense secretary, doing this for a second time, was going to bring in his expertise and streamline and privatize our military. That was his goal. He wasn't interested in defending us. He was the Secretary of Defense, and he did not defend us on 9/11. He was trying to streamline the Pentagon and make it lean and mean. Not lean and mean when it comes to the military-industrial complex, just lean and mean in terms of the soldiers. And he guaranteed the idiot George W. Bush that we can go in to Iraq and fight this war on the cheap. He said, we don't need as many troops to go into Baghdad the way your father did in 1991. We can do this smart. We can do this smart. That's what Rumsfeld told the moron, President George W. Bush. And after the invasion, it soon became evident that Donald Rumsfeld, who served twice as defense secretary, never came up with an exit strategy. He never had a plan for what happens after Saddam Hussein disappears. He had no plan on how to occupy Iraq so it wouldn't descend into a civil war. He had no plan. He actually thought that once we went in there, the Iraqi people would just rise up and a democracy would flourish without the assistance of the United States, that democracy is just a part of nature and it would just rise because people would be so happy to get rid of Saddam Hussein. And so he had no plan. He figured we'd go in there, topple Saddam Hussein and leave, and there'd be freedom in Iraq. And our soldiers had to stay totally unprepared, to deal with improvised explosive devices, which would blow up their tanks, our American soldiers' tanks. They had Humvees that were blowing up. The insurgents would plant these IEDs on the road. Our Humvees would ride over them, and there wasn't enough undergirding to protect our soldiers because Donald Rumsfeld never thought of improvised explosive devices. So our soldiers were getting killed, coming home missing limbs. It took years for our soldiers in Iraq to get Humvees that could protect them from IEDs. He was asked about this. I'll play this if I can. I'm going to try to play clips today as I learn. I don't know if I can do this, but this should be remembered. In 2004, I think this was around Christmas. I don't know if I'm going to be able to play it, but in 2004, Donald Rumsfeld visited Kuwait, where our soldiers were stationed. That was where they stayed before they went north into Iraq. And he had a town hall with our soldiers. And it had become apparent by 2004. We went into Iraq in 2003. They had prepared for this war since 2001. And our soldiers, 3 years in, still didn't have body armor. They didn't have, it was incredible what they were lacking. This is a town hall meeting that the defense secretary had with soldiers who were about to go back into Iraq. They had some time off and they were now going back in. Listen to the reaction from the soldiers after this National Guardsman from Tennessee asks Donald Rumsfeld this question.
So we've had troops in Iraq for coming on 3 years, and we've always stayed here out of Kuwait. Now, why do we soldiers have to dig through local landfills for pieces of scrap metal and compromised ballistic glass to up armor our vehicles? And why don't we have those resources readily available to us?
I missed the first part of your question, and could you repeat it for me?
Yes, Mr. Secretary. Our soldiers have been fighting in Iraq for coming up on 3 years. A lot of us are getting ready to move north relatively soon. Our vehicles are not armored. We're digging pieces of rusted scrap metal and compromised ballistic glass that's already been shot up, dropped, busted, picking the best out of this scrap to put on our vehicles to take into combat. We do not have proper armament vehicles to carry with us north.
I talked to the general coming out here about the pace at which the vehicles are being armored. They have been brought from all over the world, wherever they're not needed, to a place here where they are needed. I'm told that they're being, the Army is, I think it's something like 400 a month are being done. And it's essentially a matter of physics. It isn't a matter of money. It isn't a matter on the part of the Army of desire. It's a matter of production and capability of doing it. As you know, you go to war with the army you have, not the army you might want or wish to have at a later time. Since the Iraq conflict began, the army has been pressing ahead to produce the armor necessary at a rate that they believe, it's a greatly expanded rate from what existed previously, but a rate that they believe is the rate that is all that can be accomplished at this moment.
You go to war with the army you have, not the army you wish you had. Army to me means soldiers, not weapons. He conflated machines and weapons with the soldiers who died because he went to war without a plan. Our soldiers, like I said, our American soldiers didn't have bulletproof vests, and they were literally writing home to their friends and loved ones to send them bulletproof vests. Trillions of dollars spent on that war. It was a boondoggle, and it was a just money from heaven for Halliburton, but somehow they just couldn't supply our soldiers with bulletproof vests. It's incredible. Well, it's all about personal responsibility. That's what the Republicans will say. And apparently there's some a-holes in British Columbia as well. The heat dome over British Columbia has killed nearly 500 people in the past week. I love this. During a press conference earlier this week, British Columbia Premier John Horgan said that the fatalities from the heat dome are a part of life. This is amazing.
Well, again, I'll await the coroner's determination. As Dr. Henry said, fatalities are part of life, and the consequences or the causes of those fatalities are examined by officials that we put in place as a society to make sure we're getting the best information possible so that we can put in place programs and policies to protect people going forward. And again, this was an unprecedented heat wave, records broken day after day. The public was acutely aware that we had a heat problem, and we were doing our best to break through all of the other noise to encourage people to take steps to protect themselves. But it was apparent to anyone who walked outdoors that we were in an unprecedented heat wave. And again, there's a level of personal responsibility. I'm not ducking the
issue. Yeah, you are ducking the issue because it's not personal responsibility. It's climate change, climate change, climate change. It's the tar sands in Canada. It's the XL pipeline. It's ExxonMobil. It's not personal responsibility unless you're Warren Buffett and you're personally responsible for owning 5% of Chevron. But of course, the people in charge will say it's the fault of the people, the 600 people who died in British Columbia, even though half of British Columbia has air conditioning. Half the population of British Columbia has air conditioning because up until this year, you didn't need air conditioning in British Columbia. I think they're getting up to like, what, 114 degrees up there? This is man-made climate change. This has to be the wake-up call. But of course, the media refuses to conflate climate change with the heat. Very rarely, Media Matters, we'll talk about this later on in the show, Media Matters did a study of how many times the major networks conflated climate change with the over 100 degree heat that much of the Northern Hemisphere is experiencing, and the summer is just beginning. Phylicia Rashad, who played Claire Huxtable, has come under fire from students and graduates of Howard University, where Rashad is a dean and she teaches there. You all know that Bill Cosby was released from prison yesterday, and Phylicia Rashad immediately tweeted, quote, "Finally, a terrible wrong is being righted. A miscarriage of justice is corrected," unquote. She not only tweeted that, she shared that on her Instagram page. And survivors of sexual assault who attended Howard University are now demanding that she step down as the Dean of Fine Arts at Howard University. 60 women have come forward saying they were raped by Bill Cosby, who announced today he is planning a comeback. Congressman James Clyburn, he is number three in the House Democratic leadership. There's Pelosi, there's Steny Hoyer, and James Clyburn. They're all in their 80s. He's trying to block Nina Turner from getting the Democratic nomination for the Cleveland-based congressional seat that is up because they need a special election to replace former Congresswoman Marsha Fudge, who was appointed by Joe Biden to head housing, urban, and development. Nina Turner is supported by Blue America. She's supported by Howie Klein, but Congressman James Clyburn is trying to block Nina Turner. This week he endorsed Chantel Brown, because Nina Turner is an outspoken supporter of Bernie Sanders, whose presidential campaign Congressman James Clyburn derailed last year before the South Carolina primary. If you remember, Joe Biden had not won any states. He was going into South Carolina. It was make or break. And it looked like Bernie was going to win, and the Democratic leadership panicked. Hillary, Bill, Obama, and Clyburn panicked and they talked Pete Buttigieg, who was in second place, they talked Pete Buttigieg into dropping out and endorsing Joe Biden. And so once again, James Clyburn is ruining the Democratic Party. Some good news. The Paris-based Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development announced a plan to develop a blueprint that would guarantee multinational corporations would have to pay their fair share of taxes wherever they operate. This is actually good. This was introduced by Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen, and she wants corporations to pay their fair share of taxes. They want to establish a 15% minimum corporate tax rate so that wherever these corporations move to, at the very least, they will have to pay a 15% corporate tax rate. President Biden said today, quote, "Today marks an important step in moving the global economy forward to be more equitable for workers and middle-class families in the United States and around the world. With a global minimum tax in place, multinational corporations," he said, "will no longer be able to pit countries against one another in a bid to push tax rates down and protect their profits at the expense of public revenue." That's a good thing. 130 countries have signed on to this. It's just a blueprint. We're not there yet. But the American government, which is should be home to all these multinational corporations, they move because they don't want to pay taxes. If America gets behind this, the rest of the world will. Donald Trump's chief financial officer, Alan Weisselberg, he's 73, was paraded into a courtroom handcuffed after he was indicted because of tax fraud. A grand jury said that he didn't pay taxes on a company car, an apartment. And this is an ongoing investigation that's been going on for about 5 years. It's being conducted by Manhattan District Attorney Cyrus Vance, who is working with the state of New York. Alan Weisselberg, Trump's CFO, he appeared in court. The grand jury charged him with conspiracy, grand larceny, and fraud. There are 15 charges against him so far that add up to about $1.76 million in tax fraud. It's not a lot of money, but it might be enough. You know, he didn't pay about close to $2 million in taxes he owes the government. But, you know, you go after the low-hanging fruit to get Trump. Weisselberg was paying for his grandchildren's private schools, like $50,000 a year. He gave his son an apartment and a car, and none of this was reported. And lawyers for Weisselberg claim he is merely the low-hanging fruit that Cyrus Vance and Letitia James, she's the attorney general of the state of New York, they're trying to get Weisselberg to flip and testify against Donald Trump. Donald Trump's idiot son, Eric, when told of the indictment, said, "This is what they have? This is all they have? I think they have more. You should keep your mouth shut, Eric. They might actually tell you, Eric, what they have with a knock on the door and a subpoena." Eric Trump said prosecutors should be forced to focus on violent crime in New York, not pursuing his father. But Weisselberg is reportedly like family to Donald Trump, which means he's going to flip. So far, Donald Trump has not been personally charged, but the Manhattan DA and the state of New York is expected to announce further indictments throughout the summer. Donald Trump called the district attorney's indictment, quote, "a continuation of the greatest witch hunt of all time." According to Michael C. Bender's new book, Frankly, We Did Win This Election, The Inside Story of How Trump Lost. This is a new book that I'm going to read over the weekend because it's salacious. According to Michael Bender's book, Kimberly Guilfoyle, or I don't know, how do you pronounce Kimberly Gargoyle, Guilfoyle? Kimberly Guilfoyle. She's Donald Trump Jr.'s girlfriend. She used to be married to Gavin Newsom, the outgoing governor, hopefully, of California. He's being recalled. Kimberly Gargoyle either married or dated Gavin Newsom, the Democratic governor of California. Now she's with Don Jr. According to Michael Bender's new book, Kimberly told GOP donors that her boyfriend Don Jr. demands that she wear a cheerleading outfit and call him a naughty boy. That's not to have sex, that's just so it can promote a bowel movement. That's the only way Don Jr. can take a dump, is if Kimberly is wearing a cheerleading. And apparently he likes to be put in a cage and let out. Kimberly, the girlfriend of Don Jr., fiance probably. According to the New Yorker, Fox News fired Kimberly Gargoyle after they were forced to settle a $4 million lawsuit filed by Kimberly's female assistant, who accused Kimberly of exposing herself and forcing her assistant to look at nude photos of men. The assistant in the lawsuit claimed Kimberly frequently exhibited degrading and abusive behavior. Odd, but I can't imagine that. One point, Kimberly allegedly offered to buy her assistant silence when she realized she could get fired for all this. You know, Kimberly is an attorney. And she suddenly realized, hey, I can get fired for this. So she offered to bribe her assistant, which is also against the law. You would think you would know that if you're a lawyer. Well, remember back in January when Joe Biden warned that he will fire anybody who works at the White House on the spot if he hears that they bully or disrespect others? Do you remember that? He said, this is no place for bullying. The White House, you will respect everybody at the White House or I will fire you on the spot. Well, despite Joe Biden's threat to fire anyone treating colleagues poorly, Politico reported this week that Vice President Harris's office, is a viper's nest of abusive behavior. Staffers claim to be treated like, quote unquote, shit by the vice president's chief of staff, Tina Flournoy, who has created what they call a, quote unquote, blame culture. Politico spoke with several employees of our vice president who describe constant tension and a toxicity in the office that flows directly from Vice President Harris and her chief of staff, Tina Flournoy. Ideas, Politico says, are reportedly ignored or listened to and then harshly denigrated. One source told Politico, people are thrown under the bus by the very top. Kamala and Tina have short fuses and are abusive. Vice President Harris's chief spokesperson, Simone Sanders, said Politico's new reporting is false. She says it's not abusive here at the vice president's office and went on to call the people who work for the vice president and made those accusations. She called them cowards. But we're not abusive here at the vice president's office. Meanwhile, Business Insider interviewed seven former staffers for Senator Kristen Sinema. She's the Democrat from Arizona who was against the filibuster, against getting rid of the filibuster. Anyway, these seven people who used to work for her complained that working for her was a nightmare, it's demoralizing, and that they were unable to pay their bills. Huh. Seven former staffers said working for Kristen Sinema was demoralizing, toxic, and that working there, they were unable to pay their bills. Welcome to life. They complained that they were constantly criticized by senior aides, and they charged that Senator Sinema is lazy. Oh, poor babies. Yeah. Meghan McCain, the idiot daughter of Senator John McCain. We're going to talk about what she's married to, the fascist that she's married to later on the show. Meghan McCain, the idiot daughter of Senator John McCain, has officially quit The View. She'd been on the show for 4 years, had another 2 years on her contract. McCain will be finishing up on the show at the end of July. On Wednesday, the state of Texas executed an inmate who was convicted of killing his wife 12 years ago, John Hummel, 45, before receiving a lethal injection, prayed to God and said, "He truly regrets killing my family." 27 states in America still have the death penalty. So far this year, 5 inmates in America have been executed, all by lethal injections. 2 of the 5 took place in Texas. The other 3 were in Missouri, Virginia, and Maryland. 3 out of the 5 inmates executed were African Americans. 3 out of the 5 inmates executed were African American. One of them was a woman. The House today voted to establish a Capitol Riot Select Committee to look into what caused the insurrection on January 6. GOP House Leader Kevin McCarthy reportedly has threatened to strip committee assignments of any Republicans who serve on this committee. McCarthy denies that he has made this threat. Liz Cheney, who used to be part of the Republican leadership, she's a Republican, she announced that she will sit on this committee. Upon hearing news that Liz Cheney, a Republican, would be sitting on this Capitol Riot Select Committee, Kevin McCarthy, the GOP leader, began to mock Congresswoman Liz Cheney and asked if she's thinking of converting, of becoming a Democrat, all because she wants to sit on the Capitol Riot Select Committee. He said, "I was shocked that she would accept something from Speaker Pelosi." This is, you know, when it's only just the party, when all you do is stand for the party, that is fascism. That is what the Nazis, when you just worship the party for the sake of worshiping the party, this is a very dangerous Republican Party. McCarthy, he's the House GOP leader, he had a press conference on Thursday. He complained about Liz Cheney switching sides, all because she wanted to sit on this committee. He said, quote, "It would seem to me, since I didn't hear from her, maybe she's closer to Nancy Pelosi than to me." Pelosi says she's honored and proud that Cheney will be joining the committee. Cheney said in a statement, "I am honored to have been named to serve." And if you remember, Cheney voted to impeach Trump at his second trial when he was accused of promoting the insurrection. And then because she voted to impeach Trump, she was voted out as GOP conference chair and replaced by Elise Stefanik, Congresswoman Elise Stefanik, who, turns out, is not as conservative as Liz Cheney, but she's a loyalist. So it doesn't matter what you believe as long as you're loyal to the party and, of course, Donald Trump. This is not a crack up. This is like a solidification of the Republican Party. They are dangerous. they are dangerous. The House on Thursday passed their own $715 billion infrastructure package. The money would go for roads and bridges. This while senators in the White House are still negotiating President Biden's multi-trillion dollar infrastructure plan. This new House bill, which would of course have to go to the Senate and then be signed by Biden. This House bill contains money for roads, bridges, highway safety, electric vehicle charging stations, rail transit, drinking and wastewater infrastructure. The Supreme Court today upheld Arizona's new voting rules, new voter oppression rules is what they should be called. President Biden called today's ruling deeply disappointing. Biden accused the conservative bench of undermining voting rights, the voting rights, he says, that took years of struggle to secure. Conservatives are in the majority on our Supreme Court, and they rule that Arizona's new voting restrictions do not violate voting rights. These restrictions will prevent anyone other than family members or caregivers from delivering completed early ballots. And it would also not allow ballots cast in the wrong precinct. Opponents of this voting suppression bill say these laws disproportionately affect Black, Hispanic, and Native American voters. The GOP called this decision a resounding victory for voter integrity. Well, that is what I consider to be some of the news.